Okay, Vahid, we are live. Okay, welcome everybody to Wall Street Reporter's next Super Stock live stream for February 4th, 2021. We have back with us an exciting company, Victory Square Technologies, Vahid Shababi, the Chief Growth Officer. Vahid, welcome.
Hi, Jack. Thanks for having us again. Hi to everyone who's watching this interview.
Vahid, so you're in Vancouver, but you have this very California type of title, Chief Growth Officer, not like, you know, normal like CEO, CO, Chief Growth. It's very, so you're very Silicon Valley.
Well, being in Vancouver, somehow we have to do something about our weather to be close to California. So that was the closest thing that I found.
Excellent, excellent. So, Vahid, this is the first, so we had last week, we had your CEO, right? We had Shafin, and you know, we're going to have you on today. You're going to talk about some of the details. You know, for anybody that's just tuning in for the first time, you know, our goal with this live stream is to bring you those stocks which have that 10x to 100x upside. So these are companies going after multi-billion dollar market opportunities. They're at a key inflection point. They have multiple catalysts in place, and they have a management team that gets it when it comes to creating and maximizing shareholder value. I think you're going to agree that Victory Square definitely has those qualities, but don't take my word for it. Listen to the interview, ask Vahid your questions, and then decide for yourself if Victory Square is going to be that next super stock, that next 10 bagger or 100 bagger. So Vahid, what first I want to ask you, what is this chart behind you? I just noticed this. What is going on there?
Yeah, so the chart behind us is different portfolio companies. We still have a stake in them with a percentage of our ownership. And that's pretty much our model to find the right companies in the right industries at the right time. And working on all that, not only investing, but also working with them very hands-on to be ready for the wave that is coming in those industries to give the maximum potential to our shareholders. So as of today, we have 23 portfolio companies that we have ownership anywhere between 5, 10% to 100% that we work with them very hands-on, mostly on the companies that we have material stake and working with them and take them through our process. So that's giving, it's not only our shareholders, not only, investing in one company, but they are investing in multiple different companies in the hot sectors to have a, higher chance to basically get that, 10 times, 100 times, and 200 times based on the speed of that.
I love this model as a public company, in the microcap space. This is, we've talked about this before. I think I've mentioned this kind of off the record, in conversations I've had on our sort of like other live chats with the audience. So basically I would say it's sort of like you have this kind of like unicorn farm and, multiple shots on goal. You have these like little hatchlings, these little unicorn eggs. And I think all you need is one of them to turn into like a teenage unicorn, not even a full size unicorn, and that that could be worth $2 a share by itself. I mean, right now your market cap is what, 50 million ballpark?
Yeah, our market cap is about 50 and 60. And again, I like your description. The only difference is like all these baby unicorn was about 1.5, 2 years ago. And we've all worked with them very hands on, and they're all in the mature stage. As you saw, like Fans Unite, we spun out.
Fans is not even, it's not even mature yet. It's still teenage. It's like a young, it's
adolescent. Has a good product, has good capital, in hand to do what they need to do. Now, we also have a lineup of the few other companies that they're all gonna go out in next few quarters. Game On, V2 Games, the next one that, we're pushing it for Q1. Immersive is we're pushing it for Q1, Q2. And we've done a lot of planning and a lot of expansion in digital health, which we'll talk about it more today. You're absolutely right about that. And again, this is not only in one industry, AR, VR, health tech, gaming, cybersecurity. They're all, these are different things that we feel we're going to see a massive growth in next few quarters and years.
Okay. What I want to do is, because look, I think what we're going to do is over the coming, weeks is we're going to be talking about some of your different portfolio companies. We're going to be kind of diving in. And that's kind of what I like about, what you're doing is that there's always something new to talk about. You have so many different facets to this. What I want to kind of focus on today is just one of them, which is, you know, the digital health, the digital health space that you're in. You just announced today this acquisition. So can you talk about kind of like, you know, the Victory Squares, you know, the kind of your digital health assets?
Absolutely. So for the digital, health, we 2017, we invested in Victory Square Health. Worked with the with a few different individuals. Invested in a company called Personal Biomakers. Then our vision when we got into that was to having a 360 offering, which is easy to use and affordable, not only for healthcare professionals but also for the consumers as well. Then when the COVID happened, COVID created a lot of opportunities. And what we feel is COVID expedited the fourth revolutions. If 6 months or a year ago, you would have told people that you're going to see your doctors through telehealth, they would have laughed at you. Now, today, there is no other way. And I feel there are some of the changes that happened because of the COVID that will stay with us, because the customer's behavior is going to what is more comfortable for them to do it. So in early 2020, we acquired a company from Brazil that they're focusing on diagnostic testing. And the way that we look at that company was not have all these diagnostic testing, but also they can bring us users for our digital health, which is VS Digital. Late last year, we had like a full planning on different platforms. And then we started doing some due diligence. We figured out, what we found out is there is no good tech out there for all that. We were planning to white label different techs for different brands that we want to do. And then our team found Hydrate. Hydrate has a few different components for us. Hydrate by itself right now, in last year, they had over $1 million Canadian revenue, and they're on track for 500% growth this year based on January. Okay. Now,
this is the one that you just announced the acquisition of today.
That's the one we announced. So it has two components for us. One, the company by itself, it's a great in the right market, they're having a right offering.
Right, the right space at the right time, no question.
We're gonna help them to grow that. Number two, they have a tech that we can reuse that for other platforms that we're planning, and the licenses that they have. In November, December, we promised our shareholders that we want to have an e-commerce website to be able to start selling the test and medications. We faced with an issue that Shopify or other platform that you cannot sell drugs and they're not HIPAA compliant. So acquiring Hydrate, now we have a full pharmacy online that right now they are actually selling not only the test, but also they send people home to do the test. So we already launched our e-commerce with that, and the licenses is not only the tech, but also the licenses, the 503B, that is a pharmacy license, and also having a license to do telemedicine. So the way that we looked at this is it's a great business. We can expand it. Two, we can use this tech by ourselves, and we are planning to have six or seven different divisions in next 60 to 120 days that will be launched. And all that is going to be in different jurisdictions. Now, everyone is focusing in US and Canada. We're starting the same thing in Brazil right now to have the similar business in Brazil by getting the right licenses and all that. So that was the kind of thinking behind the Hydrate, and kind of acquiring Hydrate has changed our planning around the digital health since December. And we have a solid plan for six or seven divisions that I'll be more than happy to share more about that in this interview.
Okay, so I want to back up for just a sec. So I think a very important point. So Hydrate right now, the company, basically, this is a company that already has traction. Yeah. They did a million in revenues, you said, last year?
Million Canadian, yeah.
Okay, so that's still money, right? Million Canadian. Okay, this is not vaporware. It's not No. Yeah, the company that has market traction. And you said they're on track. You expect them to do 5x that, so 5 million revenues, 2021.
So based on the projections that we have in our due diligence, the projections is about 5x, and they hit the milestones for January. Now, again, we need to do a more deep dive in this company because we just acquired them and we're hiring the more team from the revenue perspective that we feel we can't even expand that and go beyond that. But based on the projections that they provided to us, they hit the milestones for December and January, and they're on track for that.
Okay, so yeah, it's I think the point is that essentially, the VST, the market cap is, let's call it 60 million even Canadian, right? So it's 60 million, so it's 50 million US roughly, and you have multiple opportunities in there which could be worth substantially more than this is one of them. I mean, this by itself is a company maker essentially. This thing in itself. I mean, look, there are we know of companies out there that are trading at 20x forward revenues in the digital health space, right?
So that's very interesting because the companies right now, they're comparable right now. They're two things. Either they look at the tech or the licenses. So when you look at like Everdwell, like their valuation is 1.3 billion based on 100 million projected revenue. The Roman is 1.5 billion. CloudMD, Well, True Pills. Same thing if you go to MedNow in Canada that they have like the online pharmacy. So we're gonna use this and not only offer to B2B but also B2C. Now, again, having multiple different portfolio companies underneath. One of our plans in next, again, 60 to 120 days is not only we're going to launch different brands for different audience, and we'll talk about this today, but also we're going to have this tech, we're going to tie our processing company that we already have and start offering tech and processing company for whoever wants to have a white label and start offering telemedicine or the pharmacy online. So we become that white label tech company for them with the combination of the tech and the processing.
Okay, so this is coming up in the coming weeks and months, basically.
So right now, the plan that we have is Hydreight. We're just gonna make sure, like in US, we're gonna expand the team and offerings, and also we're gonna expand the online pharmacy side of it because it's live, it's working. We just need to expand it. Now, the Hydreight will be expanded to Brazil and Canada, and then based on for the very same offering. After that, the other brands that in the next 60 to 90 days we're gonna launch is one, we're gonna have one for mental health that is gonna be white label of the Hydreight with the same offering because the future is telemedicine. We have prescriptions, we have synchronized forms and asynchronized forms, and scheduling all that and works with the insurance. So we're gonna white label that for mental health because it's a big issue after the COVID. We're gonna do it for telepets. That we're gonna offering that for the vets as well. Okay. Hospitality. We have another brand called Discreet Care that originally was supposed to be launched in February, March, and we're still on track. The only challenge is right now, we wanted to work with the white label tech. Now we're gonna put it on Hydreight. So there are some adjustment that we're making on that. We're focusing on diseases and lab works that people are too shy to go to the doctors, and they can go through the website. We have
are these gonna be separate companies that are gonna be?
They're all gonna be under VS Digital Health, owned by VSD.
But these are gonna be separate companies essentially.
They're gonna be separate brands.
So one of these that you just mentioned, like talk more about this. You said this prescriptions that people are too shy about. Is this like, are you like this? The Roman, the one we see, which is like $1 billion.
Not to Roman, but one big change that we made in VSDH in our planning is we're not focusing on one-time revenue on VSDH anymore. All the one-time revenue is gonna go to the Victory Square Health for selling tests or anything else. Okay. VSDH, we're only focusing on memberships and recurring revenue. Because when you have a one-time revenue, you're gonna get a multiple of one, maximum two for valuation. When you have ongoing revenue and membership, you're looking at the multiple of 7, 8, 10, sometimes 20, depending what you're offering. So all the divisions under VSDH, except the VSH, they're all gonna be based on the membership and ongoing. So the Roman model that you mentioned, exactly that's what it is. But the difference is right now, if somebody goes for hair loss, then after they get the prescription, they're gonna get a membership that every 3 months we send them the products.
Okay, so basically, in case anybody doesn't, so essentially, I see Roman advertising like every 2 minutes on on ESPN or whatever. Like it's what is it? It's for prescriptions of Viagra, hair stuff. So I could use both. I could use send me the 100 pack of the Viagra, the hair stuff. And I'll be good. So I'm gonna sign up. So it's a great business model. What is Roman? They're going public now, right?
Yeah, I think they're going public. They just did a raise for $200 million based on $1.5 billion valuation.
Okay, and what kind of revenues are they doing? What kind of traction do they have in the market?
I think their revenue is about $200 million or $150 million, and I don't know if that's projected or actual revenue that they have. But you get a huge multiple for that. So. That right now, if under on track to do 5 million revenue this year, if you get a 20 times multiple for that, that company by itself, I'm not talking about any other division under Victory Square Digital Health, that by itself should be about 100 million valuation. So that's how we look at it. We want to make sure we have different brands for B2B and B2C in the digital health, because that's one of the industries that we feel is gonna last long, because now that they're just starting on, and we were behind in digital health for a very long time. Right. Now that COVID pushed it for people to adopt all these changes, and we feel that's gonna be an industry that is gonna be a long-term hot sector for investments and having different companies in it.
Okay, I think also one of the key points that I think is important. So you have this opportunity, they're gonna do 5 million plus. And this is without the prescription stuff, right? The recurring, okay. And Shafin, the CEO, the CEO of Victory Square, his background was in online consumer marketing, right? So this is something where he has the expertise in scaling up this type of business.
So there are two points. You're absolutely right. So we're good in generating online traffics, and one of the reasons that we're trying to have a targeted group. Like discrete care, mental health, vets, and rather than having one big website, is because it's easier to bring the traffic. Your customer acquisition cost is lower. Your lifetime value is higher for those. And we can focus on finding other businesses to roll up under each and bring it underneath. Now, that's one side. The other side of it is we already have an ecosystem of different portfolio companies that they all have a similar personas, customers, and leads that we can send them from them into this. So from the online dating websites to different crowd that they do. Like that's pretty much like how we create our ecosystem. If you look at like how the gaming and online gambling is working together, this is kind of like an ecosystem that is going to help our companies to have multiple offerings for the same crowd of customers, or they can share the same customers for different companies.
Okay. Yes. I think it's whenever we talk about sort of new venture stage companies, it's important to know that the management the people behind it have a track record, have a successful track record in scaling similar businesses, so that this is something where, let's say, I could see this like this health prescription business. I mean, this is something that you could easily scale to, based on Shafin's experience. I mean, he could do 25 million in sales in a year. I mean, he could hit
that. That's exactly the way that
we're looking. In 18 months, I think he could hit that.
So the way that we look at this is, Shafin's, it has a very solid background and knowledge, and the team around him on online, marketing. And again, the record track talks itself. We don't have to get into the details. And the rest of the team, we have a team like myself and a few other advisors that we have. We've been on the revenue side for member management businesses and SaaS, software as a service side. That we have advisors that they used to be the VP of sales for Adobe or NetSuite, and that's how the bread and butter for these companies. And that's the vision that we have for these companies, that not only we're going to focus on B2C, but also it's going to be a B2B version that all the medical clinics, they can have their own site online business. All the pharmacies, they can have their own. They can have nurse practitioners that we can send that. Now, because of that, we also has started some conversation on partnerships. Like one of the partnerships that really makes us excited through our digital health is with BC Diabetes. BC Diabetes, Dr. Tom Elliott is one of the most well-known doctors when it gets to diabetes, and they have some wearables that at any given time, check the blood sugar and tell live to the customers, no matter where they are, that, hey, they need to have insulin, they need to eat food. And we're working on that to have a similar model with BC Diabetes as well under the VS Digital Health. So it's pretty much, again, it's supportive of our model to have a recurring revenue for this and growing it under different brands, and each brand is going to focus on their own audience.
Okay. Vlad, I just realized we didn't talk about, this is the first time you're on the program. We had Shafin, he talked about himself. Tell the audience about, your background, like how, your background, how you got involved with Victory Square.
So my background, has always mostly been in sales, marketing, and revenue. And, I launched my first, we all do some side hustles since when we were young, and sometimes you want to share the story, sometimes you don't. And so I'm going to talk about the part that I'm willing to share the stories. So I had since early 20, I started my first company and focusing again on marketing for dentists. Had an exit there. Then I started working with another software company that they were focusing on membership management businesses, like yoga, martial arts, during the time that I was partnering that company, the company had about like 5x, ARR revenue growth. And there was an exit in that business for about 80 million a year and a half ago. And then I've been working with different startups on the sales and the scalability. For me, it's just the scalability, like how we can get the quickest way to be scalable, CAC and LTV, the we can get the low hanging fruit and then work on untouched markets and untapped markets based on what you're selling. Now, the way that I, joined Shafin, one of the people that I mentored in sales, Shafin also mentored, we met over coffee, and I really don't know what happened after that. I started working on some of the businesses on the growth side of it, and then we kind of became, partner in crime in VSD for 4 years and been, focusing on finding the good value businesses and how we can add those to our ecosystem and grow them in a way that is just gonna, it's not a usual, extra, 2x or 3x, how we can expedite that to get to 10 or 20x in 2 or 3 years on all those businesses.
Okay. No, it's very interesting. Okay, let's get to some audience questions. Do you need FDA approval on any of these businesses for the digital health side?
So anything that the test related side, if we want to have our own, get a white label, we're passing everything to the Victory Square Health that it's being handled by those people. Under the hydrate side, under the pharmacy, we're gonna start selling our own tests, and also we're gonna open it to other people that if they wanna bring it in to do that. So right now, our main focus under VS Digital is focusing on all these brands that is gonna have a recurring revenue, while the VS Victory Square Health is just focusing on testing and selling tests and all that. And a quick note on that, on the Victory Square Health, we acquired this business early 2020, for $4 million. And business was valued in Q3, 2020 for roughly about 65 million worth of the business that we own 20% of that. And there was different factors for that. One of the factors were the potential and projection sales that they're gonna have from, their offerings. And in Q4, based on Q4 and Q1 2021, so having enough sales in the Victory Square Health is going to validate that evaluation, which is a 65 to 70 million valuation for that specific brand of us. And what I can tell shareholders, we're on track to the same valuation, if not higher, for Q4 2020 and Q1 2021.
Okay. Oh, one thing I forgot this. Okay, so the Hydrate acquisition, Yeah, so I completely dropped the ball in the announcement. So Hydrate, which is the digital health deal, we announced. What's the terms of the acquisition? It seems very, very reasonable. What do you pay, like a million and change for this, basically?
So it's two part. We're paying 1.6 million US in BSD stock over a course of 2.5 years. And then there's an earnout based on the milestones that we set for the management team that we're going to pay over a course of 2.5 years or 2 years around that, as well as the BSD stock as well. Again, one of the things that, you know, we're good at it because of our network of partners and accelerator programs and other partners in the market and our advisors, we try to find, you know, the assets that is undervalued. And the way that we look at it is how we can, you know, add value to them by our skill set, network, other customers, to have a huge impact on the valuation of those companies right away. So yeah, the terms is now is 100% owned by Victory Square. You're gonna have it under Victory Square Digital Health. And we're gonna divide it in two part. One, Hydrid as a business as they're doing today, we're gonna continue doing that, supporting them to hit the numbers. Two, we're gonna use their technology to white label for other brands that we have. And also we're gonna offer the technology and processing to other vendors out there that they need to have such technology.
Okay, so this, I mean, potentially, yeah, I think there's kind of like, you have a path to, you know, turn this into, you know, a $100 million valuation, just that business, you know, alone, which you paid for a couple million dollars for, essentially.
It's a you know, forward-looking statement. And again, you know, based on what is out there in the market right now, based on the projections, if 5 million by end of this year, you know, again, between 4 to 5 million by end of this year, that already is 100 million because you get 20 times of the projected revenue on Hydrid by itself with no tech, with nothing else, just the business if that money comes in, which on the December and January, they were on track for that. That by itself is 100 million, like, you know, from the market perspective, if you want to do a financing or take it public.
Okay, so let's see. Okay, so let's get into some audience questions. So I think this kind of is validate. I think, you know, this transaction, this kind of adds, you know, validation to kind of the Victory Square investment thesis, essentially, the, you know, being able to create value. And again, we've seen Fans Unite, you know, your spinoff, which, you know, has been a massive success so far. And it's, and, you know, Fans is just getting started. They're not even in, you know, they're like, you know, still. It's not a full-size unicorn. It's like a teenage unicorn right now. It's not. So there's big ups. Okay, so let's get to some questions here. At what point are we going to start hearing from the portfolio companies directly? Well, you've heard from Fans, right? That's one of them so far. Who else can we hear from? Can we hear from some of your guys?
That's actually a very good point and a good suggestion. And, you know, originally I wanted to have Shane, who's the CEO and the founder of Hydrate, to be on this interview as well, but was last minute. However, from next week, what we're trying to do, either Shafin or myself, we kind of team up with the CEO of the companies, the portfolio companies, that our audience can actually connect with them, see them, talk to them. These are the, you know, subject matter experts. So, you know, I think the next one that we're just planning to do is around Game On V2, that it's in the next company going public. A lot of great announcement is going to come out in next, you know, 10 days to 2 weeks. That in the next interview is going to be either Shafin or myself. We're going to do it with Matt Bailey, which is the CEO of the company. But it's a great suggestion, and you know, we definitely want to do that.
Okay, great. I think that's gonna, yeah. I think once you start doing that, people will really understand like the big picture. Because I think right now they're kind of don't. I think the market right now doesn't understand like what's inside Victory Square, basically.
I agree with you. Now I have to say it's you know, the feedback that we're getting from the market is huge, and our shareholders has been amazing. Like in especially in last 6 or 7 months with their feedback. Like even in the last interview that Shafin had with you, we had some takeaways like dividend and all that, that we're just, you know, we took it away and we started working with it right away on how will be the best approach for the market. Because again, at the end of the day, this should be an easier concept for people to understand in the market and to be able to invest in VSD and believe in VSD.
I think once you start bringing on these CEOs, like after you bring on like, you know, the first like half dozen, 4 or 5 guys, I think as you bring on, I think the stock, you know, I think the stock will be $2 by then.
Yeah. So yeah, the next one we're trying to have Matt Bailey to be on this interview around the Game On. Okay. And the game. And then we're going to do the same thing for Immersive and all the other portfolio companies.
Okay, so we got K Trader here. He's asking, Vahid, Shafin mentioned with share distribution of portfolio companies. Can you clarify your plans? I think we talked about, you talked about possibly maybe doing a share dividend, maybe, you know, what are the
So this conversation has been around for past few months for us. And last week when Shafin had an interview with you, and we you know, through our IR team, we got many questions, feedback, suggestions from our shareholders. So we started working on that seriously. And yes, we're going to have, you know, some updates around that, I would say in the next 2-3 weeks that we're going to send out for how our shareholders are going to have an, you know, kind of take advantage of any spin outs. If it's an acquisition, if it's a you know, M&A, it's going to be, you know, going public, all that. In next, I would say probably 2 weeks or 3 weeks, we're going to have an announcement around that. We're just you know, getting into the details for that.
Okay. Let's see here. Oh, yes, we have a super chat. $5 super chat. Cruncher says, can you provide us with an updated global COVID test sales volume? What happened to the demo test kits sent to Europe?
So that's a good question. So as I mentioned earlier, we pass all the sales tests, selling tests into our VSH arm. It's going well, and as I said, the reflection of number of the sales, that usually, like, you're gonna get a multiple of, you know, one. You're lucky if you get 2.5 because it's a one-time sell. You're getting that from the valuation, from the valuation that you see under the VSH. That, you know, if we can, you know, keep the valuation around this, you know, 60 to 80 million, that has a reflection of the sales that is happening. And yes, you know, the test was sending was sent to Europe, and I can tell you, like, it went well, and the company has been, you know, selling and sending tests not only in Brazil but other areas in the world.
This is just right, but this COVID, that's like a infinitesimal part of your business.
That's just the Victory Square Health, right? That they're doing that, and that they take care of all the sales for that. And again, that reflects in their valuation that is coming. You know, that we had the Q3 was based on the projections. Q4 and Q1 is going to be based on audited numbers, and the people can see it in their valuation. And if there's any spin out on the VSH, then obviously based on the dividend, you know, our shareholders are going to take advantage of that.
Okay. Yeah, I think you know, look, this is, you know, with this type of, you know, with the Victory Score model, I think it's important to focus on, like, you know, the big picture. Not, you know, this is not like one single portfolio company, which might be, you know, 2% of your business. And so I guess I'll break this down into two questions. Maybe. What has been the greatest revenue? This is the question. What has been the greatest revenue generator since January 1, I just noticed January 1, this is like 30 days. So, I was going to say, what's been the greatest success so far? Top, where have you made the most?
I'm going to answer both questions. I know January 1st is too soon. Like, we haven't even, like, I haven't seen the accounting for end of January for our company. But our model is not based on the revenue. Our model is based on the value, the net asset value for the companies and how that's going up. But what I can say is, which of the companies they have the greatest revenue in January, you know, 21, which is the Hydrate, the VSH, they all have the revenues that are going. But a greatest achievement for us is a few things, and again, you're going to hear more about them. One is, I feel that the acquisition for Hydrate is a cornerstone for us for digital health, because it's going to help us with, you know, online pharmacy sales. It's going to help us with different brands. It's going to have the tech, and it already has a revenue. And also, you know, the achievement that we have under Game On and V2, that again, we're going to have an announcement on that, from the putting a solid team together from the board and advisors, and, you know, being on track for listing, that is key. Immersive had the uncontained solution that we got a massive great response for that, like Forbes featured us for as one of the most promising AR/VR products, and that is going to be listed. So those are some great achievements. Now, beside that, we have other portfolio companies, like Copilot Advisors. Their revenue has been like the fastest growing company, one of the fastest growing company in Canada. Fans Unite is public, everybody can see it. So I feel there has been a lot is happening under the VSD, and those are the achievements. You know, we're very excited for 2021, 2022, because all these companies that we invested at about a year and a half, 2 years ago, is getting to the point that industry is now recognizing them because of the industry is getting hot and they all have a great portfolio underneath.
Yeah, I mean, like essentially you're in all the hot themes. We got a tough crowd today. A lot of tough questions here today coming in. So Alan is asking, what has been happening to the company that caused the stock to drop significantly since the high in 2017? What has changed to make the company more investable?
So that's a good question, Alan. So the company was heavily invested in blockchain in 2016 and 2017, early 2017. And there was a 15 to 17, there was a massive, when the crypto went banana.
I think Vi, you should also add that if you look at the chart, I mean, the stock ran up to those numbers.
Yeah, so that's exactly what I'm saying. So we were at the right industry, but we're limited in one industry and it went up and the industry was hot. We're doing great. Now, since 2017, we try to expand our investment in multiple different industries. So we get extra chance that they all gonna go up. And, again, like we have the industries get hot, get mature, goes on up and up and down. But if you have enough seed in place that is in different industries, that's how the company is gonna go up and it's gonna have more of that. So now we have blockchain, we have cybersecurity, we have SaaS model, we have digital health, we have gaming, AR, VR, insurance tech. So when you look at it, right now, that's the safety net that we created, that they're all gonna be exponentially is gonna be added and it's gonna go keep going up. But again, that's gonna, based on, our planning, that's gonna keep the company to continue going up and doesn't come down.
Okay, but so here's what I think is the takeaway, because I mean, like, I like to look at these things in perspective, which is that, look, number one is it shows you the potential for the stock, that it ran from where it started, where, 50 cents before it ran to like 250, was it something like that?
It started from 35, 40 cents, it went to roughly about $3 or over.
Okay, so it was a 10 bagger, so basically it was a 10 bagger. And then it's had like a long base, and now you're essentially getting in roughly, what is it, 60, 70 cents, whatever the stock is right now.
I think it was about 72 to 75 was like yesterday. Again, I didn't check today.
Right, right. There's an old theory, which I'm a subscriber to this theory, is where it's that stocks tend to go back to where they once were. If they did it before, it makes it much easier for them to do it again. So I think that actually is a positive, that creates a good a good possibility for the stock to get to $2.50, $3 very easily. The other thing I think you should add is also, look, you're in the Victory Square is in the venture capital space, right? You have 23 portfolio companies. The average VC expects that 70% of their portfolio companies will go bust. They'll go to zero. And 10%, 1 out of 10 is going to be the home run. They're not looking to make money on every deal. They're looking to make money on just 1 out of 10. If they do 1 out of 10, that's how these guys make the big money. I mean, that's the whole model, is to make that home run and that 1 out of 10. So far you've had fans, which is it's starting. I mean, it's not even a mature, phase, and you still How many shares does Victory Square have right now?
Right now, I think VSD has around 10 to 12 million shares. That's roughly how many shares we have in funds.
12 million shares, the stock.
10 to 12 million, yeah.
Okay, so the stock is a buck. And I think fans could easily go to $2.50, $3 the next couple of months. So that by itself, it is half the value. So there is a lot of there's a lot of like hidden gems inside of VST, which is I think the key concept. And I think like some people are focused on, I'm actually surprised, so they're focusing on like tiny little parts of the business which are not even relevant. It's like COVID test, who cares about COVID test? I mean, yeah, whatever. Let's see. Okay, what in terms of, you're gonna be having the, what I'm interested in is what's coming up in terms of these the tech spin-offs, share dividends. You're going to have news on this in the coming weeks?
Yeah, so we're having news. Obviously, there's going to be some announcement around different brands that is going to go around the Hydrate and some of the changes that we're making. As I said, the pharmacy online is live right now. People can go in and basically not only download the app, but also you can use that. It's going to be a few different news is going to be around the Game On and V2 around the team that we're trying to get. And we already got from management team to board and public listing, financing and all that. Immersive is going to have some, and you know, that's pretty much it. And obviously it's the shared evidence that, again, that's one of our hot topics that, you know, we're going to have some announcement in very near future.
Okay. Let's see. We got a couple questions about, must be a bunch of buybacks. Okay. Okay. Has the share buyback program been approved? I think there was a couple of people asking, why haven't you bought back any shares yet? So what's going on with the buybacks?
So yeah, the buyback, the management team believes that right now we're heavily undervalued, and that program has been approved, and we're working with our team, IR team and legal team to be more active on share buyback. Many different projects that we're working on right now, and based on the priority, we focus on that. But I believe, focusing on, how we take this company and show the valuation and create that valuation for investors based on all these portfolio companies in these hot sectors, that's our, the main goal and the priority. And as you see, based on the acquisitions that we're doing, we just did another one on the asset that we did from Aspen, that we believe in the in those areas we're going to see a massive growth in those. That's our primary goal right now.
Okay, so let's see here. We got let's see what other questions we have. We have a lot of people asking about this COVID. There's a lot of people focused on this COVID thing, which is the same COVID question. Like, what's going on with the COVID testing? It's like,
let me answer that question.
People focused. I don't understand that. This is like.
Let me answer that question in a way. So, right now, the COVID it brings, if we bring the revenue of the COVID into the VSD by itself or VSDH, is going to have a multiple of one, maximum two, because one time pay and it's based on the timing, and it's not like it's based on the timing of that. Now, VSH is that we own 20% of this company. Whatever sales that they have is gonna reflect in their valuation. And, the sales being over a million, 2 million, three, four, five, whatever the million would that be, it's gonna show in the valuation. And the valuation, the Q3 valuation has been based on the projected sales in Q4 and Q1, which again, our year-end financial is gonna go out, and we're on track for the same valuation, if not higher. So again, for the people that they're focusing on the COVID part, this is the answer, and this is simple math to figure out, the numbers.
Okay. Let's see here. What else we got here? Looks like a bunch of people asking about uplist. Obviously you're going to uplist at some point when the price qualifies. I think it's probably a little bit too early to talk about uplisting here. Let's see. Okay. So we're going to have, in the coming weeks, we're going to have some of the portfolio companies on. This is the game plan.
Yep.
We're going to have in terms of other news flow, what else can we expect? We're going to see some news about whether you're going to do a share dividend or what's going to happen with the gaming app.
The game on is going to be some updates going out. Immersive, share dividend, Hydrate, our mental health, the hospitality ads, all that is we're gonna, you're gonna see it in next few weeks. We're gonna have, launch. As I said, like the entire plan that we have for VSDH, it's in the matter of in 90 to 100 to 120 days, everything will be set up. Now, within next 30 or 60 days, also is gonna be other updates within that some of those brands is gonna be launched sooner than later, and some of the tech will be improved sooner than later.
Okay. Let's wrap up here. We got a couple people asking, when is the Q4 financials? When is that coming out?
I think Q4, it should be in April. I can ask my accountant team, but I think the Q4 run track to be listed in April.
Okay. I guess this is a comment here. The COVID, I think what he's saying is that the COVID testing revenues is relatively short term. It's not the main story, which I would agree with. I mean, like,
absolutely. So, and as I said, like, the VSH has been, the primary focus is generating new tests and selling tests, and which is going well. So the team is focusing on that, and again, we're happy with the results that we're getting from them.
Okay. Question about Aspen. What is Aspen doing?
So Aspen, currently we own about 20%, I believe, but we had an acquisition on some of the assets. So we that we see there's a huge market out there for expanding it and building on top of that. There was an article from Shafin in Forbes earlier last year that how the cybersecurity at home is, it's the next big thing. And the asset that we acquired from Aspen is focusing on two things. One, obviously, the crypto is going up, and I believe based on the amount of the money that has been printed by the governments, the value for the money keeps coming down. But because all the countries have done that, you don't really realize that between the one currency to the other currency. But what you see it is, something like a crypto that has no tie to any currency is gonna, maybe that doesn't go up. That's the value of the money is coming down, but you see the value there. So, the mining and the cybersecurity aspect that we acquired from Aspen, we have a plan for that to build on top of that and start marketing that.
Okay, excellent. Okay, Vaid. So on that note, let's kind of wrap up. I think the main idea is people need to really understand like what exactly, because I think we see three or four people in the questions. They're focused on like, they're focused on the trees and they're not seeing the whole forest. They're focused like not even the tree. They're focused on like a tiny, little sapling and not the massive forest, which is the Victory Square. So if you can explain in your opinion, and we'll close on this question, top three reasons why investors, should consider Victory Square shares right now.
I believe we have the number of the portfolio companies that they are mature and they have a product, they have clients, they have a good team, and they're in the right market at the right time. It's like everyone is saying, I wish I would have, invested in Google when the Google was not Google, or in Amazon when Amazon was not Amazon, or Facebook. So these are the companies that we potentially are going to be, the big giant companies. And, we have all that ready to go for the investors. And because of that, the company, the valuation is lower than, what these companies is worth. And again, we use one of them as Hydrate. And again, so that's what I feel that gives more chance to the investors. They have multiple shots that we believe the shots, majority of them are on the go, but they have the higher chance by having multiple shots by investing in one company was investing in others. Plus, when we're going to have more news on the dividend, they also might be able also have the shareholders for some of these companies as a spin out.
Fantastic. Okay. Vaid, on that note, I want to thank you and I look forward to having you and Shafin back in the next few weeks, maybe with some of the portfolio companies and some more good news.
Thank you so much. I appreciate your time and everyone who's listening to us.
Thank you, Vaid.